Phantom Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents The Slave Dancer by Paula Fox. History. Ship, the Moonlight. Officers, Captain Cawthorn, the master. Nicholas Spark, the mate. Crew, Jessie Bollier, John Cooley, Adolph Curry, Louis Gardere, Ned Grime, Isaac Porter, Clay Purvis, Claudius Sharkey, Seth Smith, Benjamin Stout, Sam Wick. Cargo, 98 slaves whose true names were remembered only by their families, except for the young boy, Ross. Shipwrecked in the Gulf of Mexico, June 3rd, 1840. Survivors, 2. The Errand. In a hinged wooden box upon the top of which was carved a winged fish, my mother kept the tools of her trade. Sometimes I touched a sewing needle with my finger and reflected how such a small object, so nearly weightless, could keep our little family from the poorhouse and provide us with enough food to sustain life, although there were times when we were barely sustained. Our one room was on the first floor of a brick and timber house which must have seen better times. Even on sunny days, I could press my hand against the wall and force the moisture which coated it to run to the floor in streams. The damp sometimes set my sister Betty to coughing, which filled the room with barking noises like those made by quarreling animals. Then my mother would mention how fortunate we were to live in New Orleans, where we did not suffer the cruel extremes of temperature that prevailed in the north. And when it rained for days on end, leaving behind when it ceased a green mold which clung to my boots, the walls, and even the candlesticks, my mother thanked God that we were spared the terrible blizzards she remembered from her childhood in Massachusetts. As for the fog, she observed how it softened the clamor from the streets and alleyways and kept the drunken riverboat men away from our section of the Vieux Carré. I disliked the fog. It made me a prisoner. I imagined sitting there on a bench in the shadows of the little room that the smoky yellow stuff which billowed against our two windows was a kind of sweat thrown off by the Mississippi River as it coiled and twisted toward the sea. Except for the wooden sewing box, a sea chest which had belonged to my mother's father, and her work table, we owned scarcely anything. One cupboard held the few scraps of our linen, the cooking pots and implements, candle ends, and a bottle of burning liquid which my mother rubbed on Betty's chest when she was feverish. There were two chamber pots on the floor, hidden by day in the shadow of the cupboard, but clearly visible by candlelight, the white porcelain one chipped and discolored, the other decorated with a painting of an ugly orange flower, which my mother said was a lily. There was one pretty object in the room, a basket of colored spools of thread which sat on the sill of the window facing Pirate's Alley. By candlelight, the warmth of the colors made me think the thread would throw off a perfume like a garden of flowers. But these spools were not used for our clothes. They were for the silks and muslins and laces which my mother made into gowns for the rich ladies of New Orleans to wear to their balls and receptions, their weddings and the baptism of their infants, and, sometimes, to their funerals. One early evening, toward the end of January, I walked slowly home, inventing a story that might distract my mother from asking me why I was late and where I had been. I was relieved to find her so preoccupied there was no need to tell her anything, even if I had blurted out the truth, that I had spent an hour wandering about the slave market at the corner of St. Louis and Short Streets, a place as strictly forbidden to me as Congo Square, where slaves were allowed to hold their festivities. I doubt she would have heard me. The whole room was covered with a great swath of apricot-colored brocade, supported by chairs to keep it from touching the floor. Betty crouched in a corner, staring at the cloth as though in a daze, while my mother, her back against the wall, gripped an edge of the brocade in her two hands and shook her head from side to side, muttering to herself in words I could not make out. I had seen damask and gauze and velvet and silk cross my mother's knees or falling in cascades from her table, but never such a lavish piece as this, of such a radiant hue. Designs were embroidered upon it, showing lords and ladies bowing, and prancing horses no larger than thimbles, their rear hooves buried in flowers, halos of birds and butterflies circling their caparisoned heads. Without looking up, my mother said, "We need more candles." In such a fretful and desperate voice, I knew she was pressed for time and had before her a piece of work that would keep her up many nights. I held out a few coins. I had earned them that afternoon, playing my fife for the steamboat crews who came to gorge themselves on the fruit that was sold in the great market near the levee. She glanced at my hand. "Not enough," she said. "Go and borrow some from Aunt Agatha. I must start work on this nightmare right away." "It's beautiful," cried Betty. "This nightmare," repeated my mother wearily. I hesitated. I hated to go to Aunt Agatha's neat house on St. Anne Street. No matter how often I went, my aunt would always direct my course like a pilot boat as soon as I opened the door. "Don't walk there," she would cry. "Take your huge feet off that carpet. Watch the chair, it'll fall. Can't you walk like a gentleman instead of some lout from the bayou?" To Betty and my mother, I called her a disagreeable and mean old maid. My mother replied that I was a surly boy and would grow up to become an uncharitable man. She was, after all, my mother said, my father's only living relative, and her grief at his death had entirely changed her nature. "We're his relatives," I'd muttered. "That was different," she'd said. Still, I had no other memory of Aunt Agatha except as a woman who especially disliked me. I had been 4, and Betty a month from being born, when my father drowned in the Mississippi River. He had been working on a snag boat, helping to clear away the tree stumps and other hidden debris that had made the river so perilous for the passage of steamboats. The snag boat had been caught by a current. My father lost his footing, fell, and sank before anyone could help him. In dreams, sometimes even when I was fully awake, a voice inside my head would cry, "Oh, swim," as though by such an appeal I could make the river return my father to us. Once my mother had heard this involuntary cry escape my lips. "He was brave," she had said, but I was not comforted. "He is dead," I had said. My mother had reminded me then that there were souls whose fates were so terrible in comparison to ours that we should consider ourselves among the fortunate of the earth. I knew she was thinking of the slaves who were sold daily so close to where we lived.
"Jessie, will you go now, this instant?"
"I've a cramp in my leg," Betty complained.
"Well, then stand up, girl," said my mother crossly.
I went out onto the street, wondering what she would have said if she'd known that this very day I had seen 6 Africans offered up for sale as cane hands. They had been dressed as if they had been going to a ball, even to the white gloves they were all wearing.
"These niggers are matchless,"
the auctioneer had cried, at which instant I was picked up bodily by a man as hairy as a dray horse, thrown to the pavement, and told to keep away from the slave market until I had something better in mind than nasty peeking. I knew the way so well, my feet took me to Aunt Agatha's without help from my brain. She received me in her usual fashion, then gave me 3 candles.
"Why doesn't your mother use her oil lamps?" she asked accusingly.
"They smoke," I answered.
"They wouldn't if someone knew how to trim them properly."
"They don't give enough light," I said.
"People shouldn't work at night anyhow," she said.
Then, catching sight of the fife which I always carried, she exclaimed,
"What an undignified way to earn your keep, playing that silly pipe. It's time you were apprenticed and learned a trade. I doubt you'd benefit from schooling."
"My mother has taught me reading and numbers," I answered as sharply as I dared.
"But who is to teach you how to think?" she snapped back.
Well, I could think of no answer to that, so I made for the door, remembering to sidestep a small carpet she prized. "Good night, Annie," I said, as though I were about to burst into laughter. I heard her snort as I closed the door. The night sky was clear. The air was faintly scented with the aroma of flowers, which grew in such profusion inside the walled gardens that belonged to the rich families in our neighborhood. Often I'd climbed those walls and peered through the black iron grillwork into the great rooms of their houses, or looked down into the gardens where, among the beds of flowers, a stone hut had been piled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.